All right, so I'd like you to meet, and you probably have already met it many times. This is Phaseolus vulgaris. This is known as common bean. This version that I'm growing is a green bean. You say, well, it's not green, it's speckled. This is a variety called dragon's tongue. And common bean is probably, if you're thinking of beans, is the most common bean. Kidney beans, kind of great northern beans, most of the different like white chili beans, black beans, most of the beans are members of this species. And there's lots of different versions. This one is what they call a bush bean. And it's called that because it doesn't get especially tall, although if you kind of give it something to grab onto, sometimes it'll decide it kind of wants to climb a little bit because naturally the wild species does climb. So I'll show you a few other varieties just to give you an idea of the diversity of this particular plant. This is a member of the Fabaceae, or the bean family, and it's got these bilaterally symmetrical flowers. So back here, this thing back here, this is the banner. Then we've got the two wings, and in Phaseolus, the keel is curled around into this crazy-looking thing. And what's neat is if you push down on these, the stigma will actually pop out. The stamens are actually all curled up in there. So to be pollinated, to be cross-pollinated, a bee actually has to land on these and kind of mush them down. Now, normally this plant and most of the members of the bean family are self-pollinated. So they produce even if you don't have any pollinators. But they can be cross-pollinated, which is why they have those pretty flowers. So these are super tasty. Now, when we harvest these underdeveloped like this, like I could harvest this one right now, these are what we call green beans. Dry beans, or if you have bean soup or chili, that's when these are mature and you take the beans, the seeds out of the inside. So these are all the same species. This is a kind of more classic green bean. This is one called Blue Lake. I was gonna save seeds from it, so I wasn't picking these because they're a little mature. So basically, if we leave these alone, they will mature and they'll produce a bean on the inside that we use as dry beans. You can eat them that way. Over here, we have pole beans. And this is kind of the natural state. All the members of the genus Phaseolus are of the Americas. So meaning North America, Central America, South America. That's where they're native to. Now, they're mostly native actually farther south of here. And they were moved... they were domesticated in kind of Central America and they were moved farther north. So right here, this is a purple bean. And they do, when you cook them, the purple goes away. That's probably a little anthocyanin. But those are the flowers again. And some of them are purple or pink. And then over here, I've got another variety. This one's called Seychelles. That's another bean flower. This is kind of the more typical of our garden beans. This kind of generic green bean shape. But this is Phaseolus vulgaris. So it's one species. And as I said, it's probably one of the more economically important species. Because they make tasty green beans. And of course, they also make dry beans like chili. Now, the thing you probably may not know, or the thing you may not know about this particular species is the seeds, the beans, are actually toxic. You say, don't we eat these all the time? Yes, we do. However, the beans contain a protein called phytohemagglutinin. It's in a group called lectins. And if you eat it raw, it will cause nausea. And you will be not very happy. Now, it has never, as far as I know, caused anybody to actually die. It's rare that even people get hospitalized because it basically just causes you to throw up for a while and then basically it goes away magically. So usually by the time you're worried about getting really, really sick, it's pretty much gone. And this actually happened to me. And maybe I'm more sensitive, but I came out and I ate one of these green beans raw. My husband likes to snack on them raw. And for whatever reason, I don't know if I just happened to get a plant that had a little bit more of this phytohemagglutinin in it, but I actually got sick and started throwing up. So I don't eat raw green beans anymore. I love them when they're cooked, but I make sure to cook them. It's also very, very important to cook really, really well the bean if you've ever had kidney beans or chili beans. Those beans especially have a lot of phytohemagglutinin in them, and you have to cook them really, really well. Because phytohemagglutinin is a protein, it can be deactivated by cooking. So don't go eating raw kidney beans or you will be sick and not a happy camper after that. So this is also a species, well, a form, cultivar of Phaseolus vulgaris. This is a variety that's called Hopi Yellow, and I ordered it from, actually from Arizona. And I thought, well, you know, our summers are kind of getting hotter and drier. Maybe I can try one of their varieties. And I planted it, and it didn't flower, and it didn't flower. And I'm sitting there going, why isn't it flowering? And being the botanist I am, I said to myself, you know, I wonder if it's sensitive to day length, because a lot of plants, they have to meet a certain requirement in terms of the length of day for them to flower. And I looked up the latitude of Arizona, and it's about 30 degrees. We're at about 40 degrees north. And I realized that that was quite a big difference in terms of day length. So if you don't know, the farther north you are, or south, the farther away you get from the equator on the Earth, the more the day length changes. So the day length will change, and that's because of the angle, the tilt of the Earth. So right at the equator, you'll pretty much always have 12 hours a day, 12 hours a night. However, as you go farther north, the summers become very, very, have very long days and short nights. And you say, well, that's great for growing plants. Well, yes, but some plants need that longer night or that shorter day to be able to reproduce. So I looked this up and I said to myself, I wonder if they're day length sensitive. And I thought, well, if that's true, eventually, as the days get shorter, as we get closer to fall, they'll flower. And lo and behold, that is what they are doing. Now, the bad news is that means that it's like it's August 19th. I'm not getting beans until August 19th. That's kind of not good. However, this plant is very different from my other Phaseolus plants. So if you notice down here, it's got a super thick stem. And the leaves are super clean. Now, maybe that's from slightly different spot that I planted it in, although they're right next to each other, and it was more vigorous, and I guess, well, it wasn't blooming this whole time, so maybe that's why. But I'm very interested in this plant now that it finally actually has flowered. So I'm probably going to try to cross-pollinate this with my other beans, because it is actually a really nice plant. Like, there's almost no damage on it. There's no feeding damage, there's no drought damage. It's a super tough, vigorous plant. It just hasn't been producing beans for me. Of course, I'll have to see what the beans actually taste like, but, you know, very interesting. So anyway, day length sensitivity. So hopefully these other beans, they've been flowering for a long time. If I do a cross with them, hopefully this day length sensitivity will be reduced in the second generation. So I'm probably going to go ahead and try that. So here we are. This is Hopi Yellow again, and it is now September 12th. A few little bugs. Those are actually literally bean bugs. But you notice that now we have beans, and actually not just a few beans, like a lot of beans. Now, this is kind of a more primitive variety, I think. And because of that, I kind of really hesitate on picking green beans when they're super, when they're super mature. So So I'm kind of trying to pick them pretty young. It's just producing tons and tons of beans. And some of these, I think it's actually designed to be used as a dry bean, so not picking all of the green beans is totally fine. But it's also, right now, if you look at my other bean plants, it's pretty much the only plant that's producing, which is kind of crazy when you think about it. It's like the rest of these have just toast, and look at this thing. And it's this big green monster still. Now, the question's going to be, can it actually set and mature seeds this late? Because it didn't start blooming until, of course, August. So here, this is one of the beans. So it's kind of getting attacked now. This is the cross that I did. So I put this, I think I did with a purple bean. Our purple bean over here. So, and it's still flowering and setting green beans. So if you want really late green beans and you want to have green beans into the early fall, late summer, this seems to be a real interesting variety. So I got this from, I think I mentioned it was Arizona originally, but it's from a place called Native Seed Search. And so they have some varieties that are, they really grow in Arizona. And, you know, the day length sensitivity meant that it didn't flower until later, but it's kind of useful, actually. Now, I would say if you were much farther north of where we are, you might not be able to get any beans at all. So this would not be a good variety if you're, you know, very much farther north than about, you know, 40 degrees north. We're actually more like 39, but if you're much farther north than that, basically this bean probably wouldn't work at all because it wouldn't start flowering until now. And then, you know, by the time you got any beans, you probably wouldn't have hardly anything. So very interesting plant. This is Hopi Yellow. And so maybe I'll try a few more of their varieties that are going to be these late blooming plants. So I'm impressed.